I do Arabic calligraphy and geometry patterns. Most of my work is inspired by the traditional methods. I travel around just to study and see the places that has like these historical architecture.
A lot of people don't even know the architecture that actually exists in Yemen. And I think mainly because of the media and the coverage, not a lot of people know what we have in Yemen. Is it any different? Yeah, it is quite different. It's quite unique. We have all these old architecture in buildings and in the houses. So if you look into Sana'a as an example and you see the buildings of the houses there, they still exist until now. And I really hope that it's not destroyed after what's happening right now in Yemen. I hope we still keep some of the heritage and what we have in there. And we have also the Yemeni the Jewish Yemenis that are quite famous with architecture as well. So they do all the glass stains and the wood carving and the plastering. They're really, really good at it.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Remind me to show you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, definitely.
Actually, my uncle came up with the first, plasters of mini sculptures of Yemeni houses. It was his idea in Yemen.
Oh, wow.
And now it's everywhere. They've been doing
really?
It.
Really?
Yeah. He passed away now, but...
Okay.
His artwork is just pretty amazing.
I would love to see that. Art is the best form is of bringing people together. We shouldn't bound things to certain ideas. But I do think somewhere when we talk about like the architecture and the geometric patterns and Arabic calligraphy, I personally do think and believe that this is a sacred form of art. And our ancestors and all of the study that they did and the dedication of their lives of putting work into it and polishing and and progressing into what they were doing. It was all driven by the love of Allah. It was the sacred. It was something that they hold very high and not just the art form. So I think it was very, very special. And whenever I'm visiting these mosques, I think it makes a huge difference if I'm looking at it from that perspective, that this was something that people dedicated their lives towards and they hold very sacred and special in their lives. So it adds much more value and meaning to it. Okay, so when we talk about figures, most of the time we think that it's a restriction, but in my opinion, this is more to do with choice. I don't think there is a lack of anything that's holding them back or stopping them from progressing. I think it's simply a choice. It's more to do with agreeing with an idea that there are better forms to represent the Prophet, there are better forms to represent the Divine, the better forms that not only represent the Divine but also complement the attributes of the Divine. So let's just say, for example, one of the attributes of Allah is that He's infinite. With the geometrical forms, they are infinite. So that's one similarity or a connection you can say. What's more befitting to represent the Divine is to represent Him in a geometrical form is more suitable. It's more worthy of representing Him. You see what I mean? Because there are, like in universe, in nature, you have patterns everywhere. So let's just say you only take a flower and the flower has like infinite patterns inside a pattern. So it's like it has a certain precision, it has a certain form, it has an aesthetic beauty. So I think all of that is representation that He made that would be beautiful by Himself. Like, so bring in the geometry in a way that it holds certain values, that is precise, it has the harmony, it has the balance, and then you can top it up with like using colors, and it gives like an idea of the infinity. So all of that, it holds, it brings geometry in a certain position where you think it's worthy of embellishing the mosque, which are literally the house of God, rather than the imagery. So I think the imagery, in what sense it's prohibited in Islam, is a completely different concept. That is to do with the worship of the idols. It's nothing to do with the representation of the figures or the prophets, no. I think Muslims in general they have this belief that the God doesn't have any shape, any form. It cannot be a human figure. It cannot be represented as like it has like a face or arms or anything like that. So it's more to do with Nur, which is light. So when you have this belief, automatically when you come to draw him, there is nothing that you can come up with. And as far as I know, the imagery of the prophet, I think that's also, it's more of the time, what has been said is that scholars and all the big ulamas has agreed onto this point that out of respect and out of courtesy, you don't draw figures of the prophets, because A, you don't know what they look like. B, I mean, whatever you're going to draw is only your imagination. But having said that, there has been examples where people have drawn Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. There is, recently when I went to Istanbul, in Hagia Sophia, there was a Persian manuscript where there was a figurative drawing of the Prophet and the other Khalifas. So it's not that it has never been done. People had the opportunity and the freedom to do that. It was their own like choice to do that, but most of the time the common beliefs that people prefer not to. I mean, first of all, can I just say that I absolutely love going to churches and looking at the artwork. Art for me is an expression. No matter, I don't. I mean, categorize it as if like no. I'm not gonna look into it because it's Western. I'm not. It belongs to church. No, art is art. When I went to Istanbul, like there was a Kora Museum in. On the European side, it's close to what we see in Hagia Sophia, like those mosaic tiles. And I mean, in Hagia Sophia, we only have like a small portion of where we can see these mosaic tiles, and which were kept. Like that's another beautiful example of keeping the heritage. When they took over, you can see like how they changed the main hall and put the calligraphy panels, but they also kept the part which was done in mosaic tiles, and it represented Maryam alayhi salam and Isa alayhi salam, and also like there is another mosaic painting which is to do with king, and he's like distributing something, if I'm correct. So that has been kept in Hagia Sophia from that time when Muslim took over. So that's another beautiful example of like keeping, because that was a place of worship at that time. It's museum now, but back in time it was converted into a mosque. But to have those figures in there, that was out of respect, because we don't have anything against that. I think that's something very intriguing for me to see, because it's history and I love history. But I would mention the Kora Museum, because Kora Museum is a small museum. It was a church before, but that has the most beautiful, I think that's the only place that has the most beautiful, well-kept examples of mosaic imagery. And it's all the story of the prophecy, Prophet Isa, Islam and the Maryam of Islam, and all the figures revolved around that story. And I think it's beautiful. I have no place to say that it's wrong, no. Because first of all, that's their way of worship, okay? And before I was saying to Sarah that the only way for us as humans is to accept. And the acceptance comes first with the idea that you respect what other people believe. If we only look back and see that, okay, churches were turned into mosques and mosques were turned into churches, we can only say now that this is wrong. But I think the way to move forward and to be at peace with the idea is to, what did we learn from it? To have the mutual respect. So I think we can implement that now in this day and age and only just learn from the history.
We leave mosques as mosques and we leave churches as churches, and if we want to build anything new, we just go build a new building. We shouldn't really destroy anything, whether it was a mosque or a church or anything else, any place of worship.
Yeah, I just want to add one point here is that both places hold one meaning.
Yeah.
And the meaning is, it's a mutual meaning. You are worshipping what?
God.
So whether it's church or it's a mosque, the purpose is the same. You're worshipping God.
Yeah.
Whether it's a church, it's a house of God. Whether it's a mosque, it's a house of God. So we share that mutual connection. I think we should hold onto this idea more than anything else, just to connect better with the other community members. And just take it as if, like, even if I go to a church, I can still pray because it's a house of God. I mean, I'm going to pray my way. You might come into a mosque and pray your way, but at the end of the day, it's a house of God and it shares the same purpose. I would say, in my opinion, if that is helping you to pray better, then it's a good thing for you. I might not feel the same way. I might think it's a distraction, but that depends on individual to individual again. But if somebody thinks that I feel better connected in the church with all these portraits around me, I mean, that's really good, because at the end of the day, the purpose of it, it's good, it's positive. They're gaining peace out of it. They're gaining comfort out of it. So it's a good thing. And if I don't agree with the idea, I can go and pray somewhere there are no portraits, because, I mean, there is no restriction, you know? You're free to pray where you feel comfortable. Likewise, I'm free to pray where I'm comfortable.
Just even within the Muslims, there is mosques where they have so many designs and artwork, and some people don't like it. They feel like they get distracted. Where I enjoy it, you know, I personally, when I went to Istanbul, I really enjoyed all this calligraphy and I admired it. And when it was the time for the prayer, it never really distracted me as an individual. Where some people say no, the mosques should be just a plain place, you know, no more artwork in it, and just keep it simple. So I guess it's an individual thing, and I think, but then the government sometimes have an effect into that. And sadly, what's happening now, that it's all politics. It's not even religious anymore. It's not even religion anymore. You know, everything out there, it's ruled by rulers, you know, like the religions are not there for, I think the only people that are left with.
That's actually a really good point, because if you look back, most of the time the churches, mosques, tombs, they were built mainly to show how much you're capable of, as how powerful you are. I think that was just a thing back in the day where that was just one mean to show. But then again, I think that was the case, but that wasn't the case. Yes, in a way you are showing how much you're capable of, but at the same time you're all of that show is benefiting your society or your community. Because if you look at the Suleimaniye Mosque in Istanbul, it had a hospital, it had a caravanserai, a guest house, it had like a library, it has a school, it had like a kitchen, library.
So much for the mosque at
library.
That time.
I mean, like, yeah. Even though it was grand, it was for the Sultan, but at the end of the day, it benefited the community. So it goes both ways.
Yeah. Nowadays, the mosque is not what the mosque was before, you know? The mosque was a place for people to sit down. The mosque was a place for people to study together.
Yeah.
All these has changed now. And people are just avoiding going to the mosque. I myself avoid to go to most of mosques now because of the certain people that has to rule the mosque, certain shiur or certain madhab. That is just dividing people, you know? Like, a place of worship should be a place of worship. It should be a place where you feel most, you know, respected, peaceful. And no matter what race or faith you are, this should be a welcoming place, you know? And if I would probably want to say today that you giving us this chance and a platform for us to talk about this, I want to say lessons for life. Thank you so much, because you are so open-minded about religion, different religions, different beliefs, different backgrounds, and I respect that about you. And I want to say to everybody out there watching us, let's not get the religion and politics divide us anymore. Let's unite together.
I would agree with Sarah, and I would like to say thank you to you. So thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak.